I sincerely request each one of you to kindly proceed towards your seats. We shall shortly be starting with the oration session, the first one being Dhanvantri. With this, now I request Dr. A.K. Bhardwaj and Dr. Anil Jaipurti to kindly proceed with the beginning of the session. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. We'll bring our conference meeting to an order, please. Just before we start, I'll say I rather have a not so pleasant duty, but on behalf of our association, we'd like to pass a condolence for one of our very energetic and young faculty, Dr. Ramesh Chauhan. I did know him personally. He worked with our team with Dr. Brigadier Zille Singh at Pondicherry Institute of Medical Sciences for 4 years. His wife, Dr. Neelima Chauhan, worked as an assistant professor of gynecology. He thereafter moved on to AIIMS Bhubaneswar, and then he's had joined AIIMS Bhopal quite recently and had been working there. He was registered for the conference and had planned to come here, but dear friends and colleagues, very unfortunately, he died on Monday. And it is a very shocking news for each one of us who knew him personally. And as a mark of respect and condolence by each one of us, may I invite all of us to kindly stand for a minute of silence as we condole and pay respect to the departed soul, one of our own, Dr. Ramesh Chauhan. Thank you very much. You may be seated. We pray that his soul would rest in peace. Yeah. On behalf of the organizers, we have an announcement. May we request for all our esteemed members who are sitting in the balcony, you are welcome to come and join us here in front. We will be able to interact a little better. A request from the organizers, if we can have all our young members who are in the balcony, if you can come, there's a lot of place here in front. Thank you very much. The Dhanvantri, prestigious Dhanvantri oration of our professional organization has been awarded to Professor R.C. Goel. On behalf of all of us, we'd like to invite you, sir, to the stage, and you will be formally introduced, and Dr. Manish will do the honors. Now I would request our president of IAPSM, Dr. Anil Purti, to honor Dr. R.C. Goel for the Dhanvantri oration.
पढ़ दियो मेरे साथ को एन खोलनी पड़ती है ना पढ़ दियो Okay. Dr. R.C. Goel is Professor and Head at Department of Community Medicine, Trichy, SRM Medical College Hospital and Research Center, located at Trichurapalli. Sir will be speaking about competency-based undergraduate curriculum for the Indian medical graduate, which is to be implemented from the year 2019, and will be focusing on learner-centric, patient-centric, gender-sensitive, and outcome-oriented and environment-appropriate things. Now I request Dr. R.C. Goel to come and take over the oration.
Invite our prestigious orators here. A gentle request from the organizers, since we are running short of time, although there is no time limit for the orations, we'd definitely like to, if possible, try to finish both the orations by 1:45 so that our afternoon session could go. This is a humble request on behalf of the organizers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Can somebody help me?
Good morning to one and all. Before the deliverance of my oration, I pray to Almighty for enlightening all of us. And I also pray to Lord Dhanvantri to bless us all the time. Greetings from the TSRMT Medical College, Trichy. At the outset, I take this opportunity to thank National IAPSM Office bearers for bestowing me this prestigious Dhanvantri Oration Award. Honorable chairpersons, co-chairperson, senior learned teachers, and my dear colleagues. Since morning, we are learning and thinking and listening all about the universal health coverage. Let me put up the other side of the coin also. I have chosen a topic which is of prime importance at this moment, that is competency-based medical education and implementational changes and opportunities to share some of my views and ideas on this particular topic. As we know that the world over, the main goal of the medical education is to create medical practitioners who will meet the health needs of the society. When I mean health needs of the society, that means their needs in all the terms. It's not only one. And this can only be achieved by a need-based, comprehensive, adequate, with high standard quality input, throughput, so that medical graduates can fulfill their role as medical practitioners or health professionals. Now let's see whether the goal is achieved or yet to be accomplished. This is a report of 1978 by World Health Organization, wherein you can see there's no relation, or rather inverse relation, correlation between the frequency of the disease and emphasis given on the transaction or the curriculum. Moreover, if you see, go through this, there's a rigid attitude over the change of the faculty itself or the teachers itself. Apart from that, they also pointed out that there is a compartmentalization which needs an integration. Not only that, they also observed One more thing, that we are only teaching in a piecemeal. There is no preclinical and clinical alignment between these integration, if at all there is an integration, was there. So let's think ourselves, what kind of the faculty, medical graduates that we are producing, if we are not giving a good input, we are not processing well, or there's a lot of challenges in the processing, the output, what will be the output, and ultimately, what could be the society will be benefited from all these things. Now, what are the gaps that we are having? Let's see the gaps. Now, inadequate training as per the role of the physician. Now, why it has come? The main important thing is why it has come all the way. Inadequate training, if I say why it has come, it's because of commercialization. It is because of declining faith in among the health care seekers, unable to meet the legal bindings. That's why we had now the Consumer Protection Act. There are a lot of allegations are there. These allegations are due to negligence, sometimes incompetence, integrity, and because of that, our stake is at questionable. And that's why we have a lot many court cases also. The World Health Organization also pointed out there is a shortage of faculty or shortage of manpower, but this is not much worry about the shortage. Whatever that we are having, which is more worry is about the, it is compounded, the shortage is compounded by the inappropriate and inadequate skills and competency. Now these competency, if we say, very recently, Government of India also published a report, that is National Health Profile 2018, says that there is acute shortage apart from the shortage, along with suboptimal standard and quality of training, including private sector too. He also pointed out that poor compensation and motivation is very, very, very poor. So, what can we do? Simply training, graduating more and more health professional is not the answer to the vexing issues. That's why we had to do a concerted efforts to transform and scale up the health professional education, attainment of the right mix of skills and competencies. Approaches, we have to adopt some approaches to transform the system and move away from the traditional focus on tertiary care hospitals to the community. And that's why we have to foster the community engagement at all the time. Such one of the thing is competency-based medical education, because earlier they have told that we do not have the skills, we do not have the competence, and that's why they have lost the faith in us. And there's a lot many court cases, other things are there. The competency-based education, they say that we have to prepare the physicians fundamentally oriented to the graduate outcome abilities and organize around the competencies on the based on social and patients' needs. Now here, they de-emphasizes the time-based training, which today we are having. It promises greater accountability, flexibility in timing, and also it is a learner-centered. Realizing the fact, education around the world started formulating the skills and competency-based education, which started right from the early 1970s. The first report I could get in 1949 by the Ralph Tyler. He first time used the competency-based education itself. You can see the Government of India the first time uttered the word of the competency-based medical education for the physician. And very recently, we know that competency-based medical education curriculum has come up. Now, how to implement? What are the various elements of the competency? The first thing that has come, identify the elements. Second is learning. It's not only learning for mastery. Unless you have the repetitive things, you cannot master. You may have the competence, but you are not a master of the you may not develop the competency totally. Assessment of the competence is a one element. Determining the components of competency and expected performance level. Preparation of the teachers, the most important, the students and institutions also. Thereby, we must focus on competence and competency, both are different. You may be having competency, but you may not be competent enough. Judicious use of training time, need-based acquisition of the skills, and shifting some of the tasks to other health workers. We should not take all the things on our head. Here I would like to mention two things here. 2002, EPSMCON, they have pointed out that is habitual and judicious. The two words we should keep in mind. If it is a only competence, if we are not used to or not performing every day and night, then it will be a problem for all of us. And WHO 2011 also, they have said that all skills should be towards a defined proficiency, a defined level of proficiency. So far, there's many advantages and disadvantages of traditional and competency-based medical education. I will not go into details of these because there's a separate discussion on the particular thing. There's a separate panel discussion. But however, I would like to definitely mention here the traditional medical education, basically we design a curriculum and then it goes to the learning. But here, the competency-based medical education means the need, competency, and performance-based curriculum. It is not first we made the curriculum and then go for the learning. Here, the need is assessed first. If you see there, everybody knows about the Miller's Pyramid. In the Miller's Pyramid, it's very clear the acquisition of knowledge and demonstrating the knowledge is not enough. But medical graduate must be able to gain competence and to perform the same. Thereby, the Millers also have added one more component, that is IS or identity, that it constantly demonstrate the attitude, values, and behavior expected of one who has to think, act, and feel like a physician. This component has been added in the Miller's Pyramid also. So far, what we had is the students read, do not learn. We all are teachers. We all are teaching the community medicine. Do they really learn it? I really have some issues on that. And there is only do learning, or what we call learning, is only for passing, not for really performing, because they are not. Even if you ask today, some of the interns, can you do this particular procedure? They say, I'm not very much confident. And hence, this is the Medical Council of India have come out with a competency-based medical education program. We have around 500 medical college and number of around 10 lakhs or more than 10 lakhs are registered allopathic doctors that we have. Last three decades, we have almost three times there is increase in medical colleges. The more worry is, really, could we get goal of the MCI, which says that we must produce the first primary contact doctor or first contact physician. This is the main thing. As I told you earlier, that in 2001, long-awaited change in the medical education, for the first time, outcome of the medical graduate education were expressed and competency as the competencies that an Indian medical graduate would develop so as to function as a basic doctor. The competency means they could able to have a desired goal. This is the goal, is to create Indian medical graduate based on knowledge, skills, attitude, values, and responsiveness. Now again, I would say that these are not enough. I may be wrong. You may develop all these things, but if you are not a perfectionist, or you can say you are not repeatedly performed, you may be confident, you may be competent, you have competency, but you are not performing in a habitual way, you are not a basic doctor who can provide which is needed by, or first physician contact which is needed by the community. And what they say, the five-star doctor as per the WHO and as per the Medical Council of India, they say the five roles of the doctor: clinician, leader, and team member, communicator, lifelong learner, and professionals of par excellence who practice all the things. Let us see what is the highlight of the competency-based medical education that has been proposed. These are only highlights. I'm not putting it all the things. Please remember that many things are may not be there since I'm not dwelling on that. Allow students from diverse educational stream and background. This is a worry. Can you add all the allopathic, all the BMS, homeopathy, Siddha, all of them into this stream? We have to think over it. National Goal says that mention competency in all fields. Is it possible to get all those things, competency, and could be practiced, could be assist all those? They say they are appropriate, but we are not competent to deal with it. We say that we do not know the management, so management has to be added into it. Communication skills has to be adequate because we have a lot of litigations on that. They say, medical counselors say that not more than 20% of the integration is required, which is almost correct, but integration everyday life, we are working in a team, has to be done. No need of multiple teachers in the class, involve other discipline in lesson plan. Even today, many of the institution do not even know what is the lesson plan. We may be practicing it, but many of us may not be practicing at all. The standard assessment against the set standard of performance, which has been given by the Medical Council of India now. These are some of the changes which have been taken place. They have added 5 things here: foundation course, early clinical exposure, electives, integration, and ATCOM. Any new things which has been done, or which has been proposed, or which has been implemented, come with always a challenge. So what are the challenges? Where we can get those challenges? For implementation, we need first is the benchmarking of the assessment. Have we done benchmarking before we embarking on implementing the community-based education for community or for the undergraduates? I suppose no. Coordinating medical student, do we have any coordination between medical curriculum and a PG residency curriculum? I suppose no. So that's all challenges that we are having. Expanding the program to the faculty development. Many of us, mostly the younger ones, might have read all these things. When it comes to working, probably we are failing into that. We do not have that much capabilities to do those things. Even if we have capabilities, we are not trained for this. Creating better systems of the student assessment, gathering its resources, learner center program, infrastructure, processing, and teacher and student ethos has to be changed. So challenges are need for the new educational technologies and programs, inertia at both the levels, infrastructure level, management level, administration level, and there's a lack of resources at our level also. Developing appropriate assessment methods, developing new teaching learning methods, faculty development in learning, teaching, learning, performing, and assessing also. There are many challenges are there which we are having. Apart from that, we have more challenges. Privatization of medical education. The way that we are having the private medical colleges and the infrastructure available private medical college is worth noticing. Commercialization, another part, which is going in the wrong direction, and politicization of this medical education. We say many things, are we practicing it? Failure of public-private models, especially in medical colleges, and even in some states, the healthcare delivery. The medical teacher and students ratio gap is increased because of reduction in the faculty and increase in the UG and PG seats in the name of competency-based medical education program. We are now forced, as on today, to do the spoon feeding. And there's a competition between the institutions that we must give the 100% result practically in all the medical colleges, including the public medical college, that is government. We are forced to do that. Is it required? We have to really think and see over it. Apart from that, let's see some of the manpower issues or manpower challenges. Lack of trained manpower on CBME. If you see the program of the Medical Council of India, it's really, they say that by 1st May, all of us of the first year student or first year syllabus, they have to upload on the website, including community medicine of 52 hours, which was earlier 60 hours. They have not mentioned even a single word of family medicine. National Health Policy have mentioned the family medicine. They have not mentioned a single word of family medicine in the curriculum-based medical education program. So we have to think over that. Mobility, frequent mobility of the staff from this medical college to that medical college running parallel to post, and in the public domain also, they are posted from one medical college to another medical college to show the Medical Council of India that we have full faculty. This is reality, whether somebody likes it or doesn't like it. There are many vacant posted lying. The government of India themselves, they are accepting that nearly 1,800 to 2,000 faculty positions are vacant even today. There is apathy and indifferent attitude of the faculty. Brain drain because of the poor salary structure. Multitasking role. We are teachers, we are field workers, we are researchers, we are all in one. Is it possible? If you go to the places or the countries where the competency-based medical education is practiced, they have only one role. Either they are teacher, or they are researcher, or they are field worker, or only one role they have, they are doing the justifying their role. Or can we do it? That's another question. Compromise safety and security. Nowadays, we are listening a lot of attacks on the doctors. Why they are there? Are we safe in the situation? This is one picture of salary that you can go out from this. See, if you go to the MBA or do any IIT, you get more than this, what you are having. This is a reality that the government of India has given on some of the website. So this is reality I'm showing. I'm not speaking, but I'm showing. Apart from that, we also have some issues like lack of infrastructure. Many of the institutions do not even have the space for a skill lab. Everybody has seen the skill lab of our own institution. Either it is not there, if at all it is there in a very small room. If some room is also there, there may be lying one or two mannequins, dissociated mannequins. Can we have such kind of skill labs? Can we train them? It's again a million-dollar question. Forget about the SIM men, SIM women, SIM units, SIM child. Forget about that. We do not have the basic thing of even training them how to suture, how to give an injection. We do not have those mannequins too. So those are the issues that we have to see. Computer lab. We all say we have computer lab. Ask your library person or the computer lab in charge how many of them they are really working. How many they are really having the internet connection. That's another thing. The assessment is another part. Assessment of all the faculty performance, the students, and the others. I'm dealing with here some of the assessment challenges that we are having. All assessments are sampled. You cannot assess all the things. Only some of the performances that you can do or assess. In one day, you are assessing 20 people on the performance. Is it possible to do that? I think it's mostly impossible, or rather 20-25. Thus, as more the sample are needed, it's more of the subjective bias is also involved, because assessment involves judgment. Whenever their judgment comes, the subjective bias comes in. We have to do the triangulation. We have to do quantitative and qualitative assessment also. All of them, they really pose challenges. Multiple assessment tool. One assessment tool we cannot have. We have to have the multiple assessment tool. We have to design those tools now if we want to implement that. Feedback from all the stakeholders. Today we are saying that we are getting the feedback. How the feedback has been generated in a medical college, I know. And everybody must be knowing that we are taking what kind of feedback that we are having from the students, or forget about the community. We are not able to generate even from the students. So that is a feedback challenge that we are having. Assessment driving learning, especially these assessment has to be done on the workplace, either community or hospitals, or we are saying that some of the other things can also be used, like portfolio, OSCE, OSPE, and so other things, mini CX and other things are can be done. Perfection as an illusion, maybe it is, but we can try for it. So, friends, apart from that, challenges are many more. The supportive administration that we need, the financial support, whatever support today we have is inadequate. Poor coordination at all the levels, even in the medical college, I would say, why medical college, even our own departments? Introspect ourselves. So that is another thing. Forget about the state level and the district level also. Timely reform. This particular curriculum is coming after 21 years. So where is the timely reforms in community or curriculum? Do we have that? Adequate guidelines. We have this particular competency-based medical education as on today to be implemented from the August 2019. Do we have the details of the assessment? I will say no, a big no. We do not have the details of assessments as on today. They have left to us that these could be the assessment parameters. Now every individual will have their own saying, and then there will only again, no standardization will be there. So responsibility is another important thing. Many of us know who has worked in the medical education unit or department that responsibility is given, but without any authority. That's another important issue is there. So whenever we have challenge, we have to show some courage and turn into the opportunity. So what are the opportunity? We are the committee persons. We will never say we cannot do it. We will do it, we can do it, and we shall do it. So when we say that it's a faculty development, you will have the intense training. I mean intense training, not only training, accreditation training, adopt a new role as facilitator, preparing the new resources, new learning method, these are all opportunities for us. Developing relevant assessment tools, which is a major challenge today with the MCI also, and methods. Acquire CBME expertise and leadership, and then you could be international leader or advisor or trainer. Friends, wherever the challenge is, we have some strategies also. There are some strategies are there. There cannot be any quality without an improvement education system and without a quality teacher. But important thing is the base. If you see this base triangle, the planning and governance. If you see this governance planning, are we planning before we do anything? How many medical colleges, they really have the whole module of planning on each topic or lesson plan? Maybe very few. Second comes admission process. What kind of procedures that we are having? Then comes educational pathways and ladder, what they are having. So on each of them, we have to really develop on that interprofessional education, continuing medical education or professional education, and of course, the faculty development. These are some of the strategies that we can do it in a proper way. Apart from that, quality control mechanism has to be adopted. Teaching methods, protocols, teaching protocols, clinical processes, like NABH is coming to us, any NAC is coming to us, NABH is coming to us, NABL are coming to us, now we are all striving for that. Now if they are coming, they are asking where are the policies, where are the protocols, where are the procedures, where are the documentation, and then they ask them if make those in some years, or maybe 1 year or 2 years or so. Another thing is, I would like to say here that it is up to the policymakers at the higher level that take this step to stop private practice by faculty in all the teaching institutions, including private and public, both. Attractive salary has to be given to them. The more important thing, every institution must have the comprehensive policy for HRS. This policy should cover staff recruitment, retention, transfers, posting in difficult places, incentives, performance management, and competency-based career advancement programs. It has to be considered. In conclusion, Having said so, we cannot progress further until we adopt a transformative learning approaches, methods for medical education health professionals, education and training. And the key is to sustain expansion. We may change today. Can we sustain that? Anyway. This is not working. Anyway, and second thing is we have to increase the quality, quantity, and the relevance of the health professional. These are the things that we have to do. These two things has to be done in a classic way. Last one was one slide. We say quality education. We can have accelerated success only by the quality education, which has been quoted by two of our stalwarts in social sector, education sector, and all around sectors, which we can see here, Rabindranath Tagore and Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi said that we have to take care of everyone. Similarly, Rabindranath Tagore also said we must develop ourselves for all of us. Having said that, we can do it, and only thing is we have to train and retrain our minds, our faculty, and we can bridge the gap between these two. With those words, I'm sure that we all will strive towards the better future, and the competency-based medical education will see a day where it is complete thing. Thank you very much for your kind attention and your kind listening. Thank you very much. So nice of you.
We thank Professor R.C. Goel for giving us so much food for thought on competency-based medical education, something that each one of us need to work together. There's still a lot of uncertainties, challenges that sir has pointed out so, but I'm sure with passage of time, each one of us could be part of that team in our respective areas of work. And I'm sure as members of IAPSM from the Department of Community Medicines that we work, we could be important stakeholders in implementing this program at the ground level.
Now I request our organizing secretary, Dr. A.K. Bharadwaj sir, to felicitate Dr. R.C. Goel with a certificate as well as memento. Sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Anil Purti and Dr. Bharadwaj, for the Dhanvantri oration. Now I invite our IPSM Secretary General, Dr. A.M. Kadri, sir, and the organizing chairperson, Dr. Anmol Gupta, on the stage for the Harcharan Singh oration. Now I invite Dr. Sunila Garg, madam, for the oration.
Good afternoon.
Medal.
They're telling me about the
protocols, so I'll sit here. Thank you so much.
Now I request Dr. A.M. Kadri, Secretary General of IAPSM, to felicitate Dr. Sunila Garg with the medal. Now I request Anmol Gupta sir to just brief the audience about the various activities and the bio sketch of Dr. Sunila Garg. Madam.
Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to say a few words about our orator, Professor Sunila Garg. Professor Sunila Garg is the professor and head of the Department of Community Medicine, Maulana Azad Medical College and Associated Hospital, New Delhi. She is advisor, Indian Council of Medical Research, member, Task Force, Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, advisor, World Health Organization, Honorary Director, Society for Sound Hearing International, Honorary Secretary General, Sound Hearing 2030, Member, Central Coordination Committee, NPPCD, Ministry of Health, Family Welfare, Government of India. And she is Advisor Chairperson to the Blind Mission for Disability. As far as her academic qualifications are concerned, she has done her MBBS and MD 1982. She has 38 years professional and research experience. Regarding award and fellowships, she has got the WHO Bulletin Fellowship Award in 1992-93, Overseas Development Agency Fellowship, British High Commission from July 1996, awarded Indian Public Health Association IPHA Fellowships in 2000, awarded State Doctor Award for Meritorious Services in February 2003, awarded State AIDS Award for contribution in the field of HIV AIDS 2002, awarded Fellowship of Indian Academy of General Practice in 2004, awarded IMA President Award in 2005, awarded Fellowship by CBM 2011 for attending course at London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, Public Health Planning and Management for Hearing Impairment, awarded Double Helical National Award for the Public Health 2015, IMA Jury Member for the National and the State Health Award 2016 and 17, Double Helical and awarded K.N. Rao Memorial Oration of Indian Health Association in 2018.
Doctor, thank you so much for all that honor. So much. It is. Thank you so much.
So
with 8 years of experience, I think every year we keep adding something. Thank you.
So I invite Dr. Sunila Garg for his award. Thank you.
Respected dignitaries on the dais, Dr. Kadri, Dr. Gupta, and Dr. Bhardwaj, the organizing chairperson, my all senior colleagues, my friends in the audience, it's my proud privilege on this day to deliver Harcharan Singh oration, which I am going to target at universal health coverage for maternal and child health initiatives in India. I dedicate this oration on the event of International Women's Day to all the wonderful women and their families. So that is where I begin my oration with. And 74 happens to be founding year of IAPSM, and it also happens to be founding year for my joining Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Medical Sciences at Sevagram. So that is where I bring these correlations together to you. So if we look at, I think, please give a big hand to Government of India, Prime Minister and Health Minister for bringing a remarkable decline in maternal mortality. Here you can see our Poonam Khetrapal Singh, our Narendra Modi ji,
our Jagat Prakash Nadda ji, who said that basically we have brought down our maternal mortality by 37 points since 2013, which is a remarkable decline. And this was, we were supposed to obtain this whole thing very, you know, in the year 2018, but we have achieved it much earlier. So now, you know, from this platform, I'll be talking a bit about universal health coverage. Universal health coverage means that all people and communities can use promotive, preventive, curative, rehabilitative, and palliative services that they need of sufficient quality to be effective, while also ensuring that use of these services do not expose the user to financial hardship, which our Honorable Education Minister also told us in morning. So three key things are there: equity, quality, which also Dr. Goyal mentioned just before me, whether it is in any field, but in systems it becomes all the more important, in protection against financial risk. Now, if we look at some of the key healthcare indicators, I'll only point out to two very things that look at the year 1990 and look at the year 2016. When we talk of maternal mortality ratio, it's 556 and now we are 113 2016. National health policy talks of bringing it down to 100. Neonatal mortality rate 57, now we are 24, and we have to bring it down to 16 by 2025 and less than 10 by the year 2030. Infant mortality rate 89, and we are 34 now, and we have to bring it down to 28 by 2019. And under 5 mortality rate 126, we have brought it to 39, and we have to bring it down to 23 by 2025, and less than 25 basically. We are talking in terms of sustainable development goals. So even our target of national policy is even lesser. Total fertility rate 3.8. Now we are 2.2 in 2016, and national health policy in Visage is 2.1. So now if we talk of some of the key indicators, most of us are public health professionals, we are aware of, but I'll draw your attention to one fact, that mothers basically, you know, who received 4 antenatal care visits were only 51.2%, where I'll talk of our Prime Minister's ambitious scheme. But registered pregnancies for which mother received mother and child protection card through our digital initiative is 89.3%. Mothers who received postnatal care from doctor, nurse, LHV, ANM, midwife, and other health personnel within 2 days of delivery, which is again very remarkable, are 62.4%. Another very significant achievement, we'll say, is to institutional births, in terms of 78.9% institutional deliveries took place in the year 2015 and 16. Now, if we look at the India's contribution to global burden, it contributes in many ways to population. 18% of our population, childbirths 20%, newborn deaths 27%, under 5 deaths 22%, but we are also contributed to 15% of maternal deaths, and extremely poor, we are contributing to 33%. So that is where, keeping in view all these things, there was a strategic approach by Ministry of Health, Government of India, towards reproductive, maternal, newborn, child and adolescent health, which is a heart of national health mission. So this is also aided by USAID, UNICEF, UNFPA, NIPI, and the implementation is in terms of continuum of care. That means we are following across the life cycle, from adolescence, pre-pregnancy, pregnancy, birth, newborn, postnatal, childhood, cutting across our clinical services, cutting across our sub-centers, family and community level, and following our intersectoral coordination. Now, we are all aware of the metrics for high-impact RMNCH interventions. Now, right from reproductive health, we are starting focusing on our contraceptive methods like tubal rings, intrauterine contraceptive devices, OCPs, condoms, emergency contraceptive pills, and pregnancy testing kits, which is a newer and a pushy achievement. Then on maternal health, we have added injection oxytocin, tablet misoprostol, injection magnesium sulfate, and tablet mifepristone. Basically, this is being provided at the facilities which are conducting safe abortion services. Then for newborn health, we have added injection vitamin K, mucus extractor, and also vaccines in form of BCG, oral polio vaccine, and hepatitis B. If we look at child health, we have added on to oral rehydration salt, which was earlier there, zinc sulfate dispersible tablets, tablet syrup salbutamol and sorbitol nebulizing solution, vaccines in form of DPT, measles, Japanese encephalitis in 19 states, pentavalent vaccine in 8 states, and syrup vitamin A. Then for adolescent health, we have got tablet albendazole, tablet dicyclomine, and sanitary napkins. Then we have got also cross-cutting interventions as per the level of facilities in terms of tablet iron and folic acid, syrups and tablets like paracetamol, trimethoprim and sulfamethoxazole, chloroquine and dexamethasone, antibiotics in form of capsules and injections, ampicillin, metronidazole, amoxicillin, injection gentamicin, and injection ceftriaxone. Then clinically, we are added equipments like digital thermometers, weighing machine, BP apparatus, stopwatch, cold box, vaccine carrier, and testing for hemoglobin, urine, and blood sugar. Now, one thing which is very important and all of us have to remember, that pregnancy is a very important for event for the woman. So every woman has got right to respectful maternity care. Her little bundle of joy and hope. Make childbirth a memorable experience. Make every mother feel valued, respected, and cared for. So make her feel special. That is one thing which I don't talk on the occasion of International Women's Day, but on every occasion. So what is respectful maternity care? The care that respects the values, culture, choices, and preferences of a woman and her family within the context of promoting optimal health outcomes. What is respectful maternity care? In fact, we have to empower the woman that nobody can physically harm you, nobody can force you or do things to you without your knowledge and consent. No one can expose you or your personal information. No one can humiliate you or verbally accuse you or abuse you. No one can discriminate because of your something which they don't like about you. No one can prevent you from getting the maternity care you need, and no one can obtain you or your baby, or no one can detain you and your baby without your legal authority. So for all these, we have to sensitize our providers for universal rights of childbearing women. We have to train service providers on interpersonal skills, behavior, and clinical empathy. We have to set in place a functional grievance redressal mechanism. We have to also create an enabling environment for the providers, and we have to highlight respectful maternity care component across the maternity care. So respectful maternity care framework focuses on right to confidentiality and privacy. That means guidelines for access, handling, storage of case sheets and records in order to ensure confidentiality, ensure physical privacy in labor room, the direction of labor tables, screen curtains, gowns for mothers. Each one of you, please ask yourself that how many of you have these facilities in your own setup, whether we are talking of the birthing heads right till the tertiary hospital level, including draw sheets, drapes to cover the woman appropriately during labor, and confidentiality while handling HIV-positive women. So ultimately, privacy matters to a woman. Every woman has right to privacy and confidentiality. Another thing which is very, very important is Pradhan Mantri Surakshit Matritva Abhiyan, a new initiative which is on 9th of every month. And we are very proud of this because this is an additional checkup when we go for evaluation of NHM, that all government facilities have the privilege of having a private medical practitioners who are requested to join the campaign on the voluntary basis. And that is where we have maternal mortality ratio in India, which has declined by 70.2% as compared to global incidence of 44.7%. So this is the decline. So here over 16 million antenatal checkups have been conducted and over 8 lakh high-risk pregnancies have been identified in 25% checkups have been done in high-priority district. Over 13,100 facilities have been provided by PMSS services and over 5,300 volunteer doctors from private or NGO sectors have been involved. So every private sector doctor voluntarily has to say that I pledge for 9 under Pradhan Mantri Surakshit Matritva Abhiyan. Another important initiative is gestational diabetes management, which is a new strategic approach which starts right from antepartum period. That means we do early diagnosis and management of gestational diabetes. During intrapartum period also, gestational positive and controlled women, you know, we are promoting those women with the gestational diabetes, we are promoting institutional deliveries, and gestational diabetes positive women with uncontrolled, this thing we are referring them for emergency obstetric care. Even this spills on to the newborn care, where we are promoting early breastfeeding, We are doing newborn blood sugar monitoring, management of neonatal hypoglycemia and referral maternal care, counseling for 6 weeks and follow-up. Then again comes the linkage with the immediate postpartum and early neonatal care, where we are focusing on during the postpartum period on oral glucose tolerance test at 6 weeks and linked with NCD program. Then annual blood glucose follow-up if OGTT result is less than 140 and refer to medical management if oral glucose tolerance test is more than 140 or 140. And another important thing which was pointed out in morning also, and we have a session also on very ambitious program that is Anemia Mukt Bharat, where we have got almost 450 million beneficiaries, reaching almost to 50% of the country's population. Look at the ambitiousness and length and breadth of the program, where we have got 24 million children between 6 to 59 months, 134 million children between 5 to 9 years, 115 million adolescent boys and girls, 30 million pregnant women, 27 million lactating mothers, and 17 million women of reproductive age group. We are having 6 strategies under this whole program. That means number one focuses on prophylactic iron and folic acid supplementation. The second one talks of periodic deworming of children, adolescents, and pregnant women. The third talks of intensified year-round behavior change campaign based on solid body, smart mind, and delayed cord clamping. Testing of anemia during using digital methods and point-of-care treatment. Then mandatory provision of iron and folic acid fortified foods in the public health programs, and addressing non-nutritional causes of anemia in endemic pockets with special focus on malaria, hemoglobinopathies, and fluorosis. Ultimately, 6 beneficiaries, 6 types of interventions, and 6 types of institutional mechanisms through this platform. So 6 by 6 by 6 strategies there. Then we all have got worm-free children or healthy children. This is what is our motto. So we have got a National Deworming Day on 8th February 2019, because always we have to give focus and give message to the community that the children who are anemic and those who have worms always feel tired because of malnutrition and anemia and can have impaired physical and cognitive development. And this message, what Dr. Goyal just talked about, has also got to go in our skill-based curriculum also. So those children who cannot be dewormed on this particular day has to be administered during the mop-up round that is on 14th of February 2019. Another important initiative is Lakshya, that is National Labor Room Quality Improvement Initiative. This brings together all the existing efforts which coalesces quality assurance and quality improvement. And also there is a coordinated effort of National Health Mission, state health departments, and medical colleges. Lakshya aims to adopt a holistic and comprehensive approach at all levels of care to improve and strengthen quality of care. Remember, today's era, whether we talk of education, service provision, quality is the buzzword during the intrapartum and immediate postpartum periods. So again, the goals and objectives are to reduce maternal and newborn mortality, morbidity, and stillbirths by addressing antepartum, postpartum hemorrhages, retained placenta, preeclampsia, eclampsia, etc. Improve the quality of care during delivery and immediate postpartum care, where we do stabilization of complications, timely referrals, and also effective two-way follow-up. Then enhance the satisfaction of beneficiaries through respectful maternity care. Then again, we are harmonizing the efforts in Lakshya through these 4-pronged approach. That means first key important thing is standard of care, where national quality assurance standards through NHRCs have already been defined. Then we have skill-based training about which Dr. Goyal talked about, but we are focusing in a big way through Dakshata, which is focusing on the maternal care. So here we are aiming at competent and trained service providers. We are having the facility ownership and accountability through quality insurance, so care around birth, and we are having optimal experience of care through white ribbon allowance, care around care birth. So this is 6 days skill-based training lab through Dakshata. That means we are having guiding principles for the training in the form of we have to train and target all the staff who are involved in childbirth. We have to rapidly saturate all the facilities with the trained providers. We have to monitor attendance, that we have to see that everybody gets trained, and we make sure that all trainings are residential to facilitate even hands-on practice. So the scope of Lakshya goes beyond medical colleges now. So all the medical, government medical colleges, hospitals, all the district hospitals and equivalent health facilities, all the designated first referral units and high case load CHCs with over 100 deliveries, or you know, we say talk of 60 deliveries per month in hills and desert areas. So rapid improvement cycles under Lakshya are focusing on six things. Number one is real-time partograph generation, usage of safe birth and surgical safety checklist, and strengthening documentation practices. This is what we doctors are lacking. We have to strengthen our documentation practices for generating robust data for driving the improvement. We have moved from where to where. Second is presence of birth companion. I don't know in how many facilities across the states in your country you have started doing that. In Delhi, it has already started happening. Birth companion is permitted, respectful maternity care, and enhancement of your client's satisfaction. Assessment, triage, and timely management of complications, including strengthening of referral protocols. Fourth is management of labor as per protocols, including active management of third stage of labor. So we also have to focus on that labor room must have standard operating protocols, which is displayed in black and white. Essential and emergency care of newborn and preterm babies, including management of birth asphyxias, timely initiation of breastfeeding, as well as kangaroo mother care for the preterm newborn. And cross-cutting across that is infection prevention, including biomedical waste management. Another important initiative which has been focused by Government of India is Mother's Absolute Affection Program to promote, protect, and support breastfeeding, which has four basic components. That means we start creating mass awareness generation for appropriate breastfeeding practices. We have to have capacity building of the healthcare providers, lactation management centers, mothers meetings by ASHAs, and infant and young child feeding practices for ANMs of all the sub-centers, and recognition of best performing baby-friendly facilities by facility awards. So our outcome is around 3.7 lakhs ASHAs and 82,000 health staffs have been sensitized for breastfeeding promotion strategies. Again, we have also got very, very strong and robust IT initiatives. One of them is Mother and Child Tracking System, or RCH portal, where cumulative registration of women is now 14 crores and 12 crore children we have enrolled through this portal. Kilkari is again an app through which we are sending regular audio messages which are delivered weekly. Then Mother and Child Tracking Facilitation Center. Then we have got some of the e-initiatives like ANM Online or Anmol, e-Rakhtkosh, which is implemented, and Mobile Academy for upgrading the skills and knowledge of ASHA. So this is where I'll show you one of them, and PMSA's portal and mobile app. So Anmol online application is Android-based. It is introduced by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare with the help of UNICEF, and it involves ANM to enter and update data for beneficiaries of in their jurisdiction, and it also ensures prompt entry and updation of data. Look at this. If we have to look at performance of one of the ANMs, we go to the dashboard, we look at our RCH register, we can look at village health and nutrition days, eligible couples with a pregnant woman, child care, and all this. So this is a very, very friendly app which we can do that. And we can also look at the plan through this app, sub-center-wise, village-wise, service-wise, ANM-wise, ASHA-wise, beneficiary-wise, high-risk pregnant woman-wise, and low birth weight child-wise. So this is the app which is very, very user-friendly and has upgraded the skills of our ANMs also. Now, Mobile Academy is a free audio training course designated to expand and refresh the knowledge base of ASHA and improve their communication skills. Again, this is mobile phone-based, anytime, anywhere audio course launched in Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, and Uttarakhand. And ASHA can access 240 minutes of course via toll-free number and is given a certificate at the end of the course. So this is how this toll-free number is 1-800-3010-1704. And then we have a safe delivery application which empowers our skilled birth attendants to provide safer birth for mothers and newborns, and has videos, action cards, drug lists, and procedures for her. Now, again, it is aligned to Government of India's clinical guidelines, available in Hindi and English, easy availability for anytime direct access by end users, handy resource for facility staff to refresh knowledge on basic emergency obstetric and neonatal care. It signals the functions, and availability of free of cost download on mobile phones. And also, this is available offline access to entire content of the app.
Another very important initiative which has been launched and where we have made a difference is maternal death surveillance response. We have moved from MDR to, we have moved to MDSR. That means we are talking now, why did the mother die? Why, where did the mother die? How did she die? So this is a continuum, and it's a continuous action cycle at community level, facility level, hospital level, regional and national level. So we are focusing on surveillance, we are focusing on monitoring and evaluation, and we are also focusing on response. So we are identifying and notifying deaths, we are reviewing the deaths, we are responding and monitoring the response, and we are analyzing and making recommendations. Now, there are also fewer initiatives in family planning. That means we are focusing on expansion of basket of family planning choices. Three new methods are introduced, that is injectable MPA under Antra program, progesterone-only pills, and centromin, that is Chaya. And under Mission Parivar Vikas, which is implemented in 146 high fertility districts of 7 high focus states of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Assam, with total fertility rate of 3 and above. So again, we have got a new family planning media campaign. So these are some pictorial pictures. And we have got also a DMPA card where we talk about the facility, the client's name, the address, the date of injection, when is our next visit. This is how it looks like. Then again, we have got the postpartum intrauterine contraceptive device.
It's really very informative, but may I request to wind up in the 2 or 3 minutes.
Then we have got package of service providers for ASHA, that is 150, and rupees 300 to be paid to acceptors of PPIUCD to cover the incidental costs and travel costs for 2 follow-up visits. Now, this is a new kit which is being introduced, that is Nai Pahal for kit for newlyweds, where we are going to give a jute bag marriage registration, which is going to contain, you know, a jute bag marriage registration form, the pamphlets, pack of 3 condoms, oral contraceptive pills, 2 cycles, we are going to give emergency contraceptive pills, 3 grooming and hygienic bag, pregnancy test kits of 2, and information cards, which is going to be filled with contact information by the respective ASHAs. And then again, so this is all about, you know, the home delivery package of contraceptives. Now, the initiation and focus is also on promoting vasectomy, because we are on the decline for as far as the male contraceptive methods are contained. Now, another important aspect is childhood interventions, where the government is focusing on newborn health interventions, nutrition-related interventions, interventions to address pneumonia and diarrhea, interventions to address birth defects, disability delays, and deficiencies through Rashtriya Bal Swasthya Karyakram and immunization activities. So this is where is the Vatsale Matri Amrit Kosh Lactation Bank has been launched. So lactation management centers are being established at the medical colleges, lactation management unit at the district hospital, and lactation support unit at all delivery points, where we are going to focus skill lactation support and counseling. Again, we are all aware of this program, Mission Indradhanush, and pneumococcal conjugate vaccine was launched in this very state of Himachal Pradesh. And we are all aware of this MR campaign, but due to some reasons, it has come to halt in Delhi. And then again, we have got a package of services for our adolescents through Sathya Resource Kit. And also, we do have, you know, important information on menstrual health for the girls. So government launches Sathya Resource Kit. This is there, where peer educators are acting as catalysts to impart age-appropriate knowledge. So way forward is through Ayushman Bharat, which is again, so it's a very, very ambitious scheme quoted all over India through health and wellness centers. And again, you know, the last new initiative is a new cadre of certified midwives to improve maternal and infant care, which has been launched on December 2018, where Government of India has announced guidelines on midwifery practices, which includes recommendations for midwifery training and certification. And 5 training institutions are to be set up in 5 states of Assam, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, and Uttar Pradesh. So reach the maximum number of people in the most remote areas of the country through continuum of services, remote routine monitoring of interventions, and constant innovations. So we have to be the change ourselves if you want to see this in the world. So I come from Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Medical Sciences. This is where my tribute is to. Thank you very much.
Today is the International Women's Day. Our oration is on the issue of the very sensitive issue of the women, motherhood and the childhood.
and the oration is presented by the one of the senior most stalwarts member of the IAPSM, women member of the IAPSM. I think no better timing can have for the oration on this particular topic. So really, thank you very much, madam, for a very informative and comprehensive oration. And we are looking forward your, we are sure that members are enlightened with your presentation and looking forward that people will definitely work in the, for betterment of the mother, improving the health of the mother and the child. Thank you very much.
With this, I will now request Dr. Anmol Gupta to kindly felicitate Srimati Sunila Garg with a memento and a certificate. Ladies and gentlemen, can we please have a warm round of applause? Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Gupta, and thank you, Dr. Kadri.